Now, the Inca Empire in the Andes suffered the exact same fate. 90% or more of the South Americans died. And they actually started dying before the white invaders ever arrived, which caused confusion and dismay. When Pizarro crossed the Andes with his 80 conquistadors and 60 or so horses and 2,000 pigs, he found social chaos. Huayna Capac, the Inca leader who had just finished triumphantly extending the empire from Chile to Ecuador, had died of smallpox in Quito in 1527, along with his eldest son, who was his heir. His two younger sons then fought a brutal civil war for control of the empire. The younger brother, Atahualpa, finally defeating and assassinating his older brother, Huáscar. This brutal war exacerbated the effects of the epidemics, and the weakness and confusion of the reduced Inca population gave Francisco Pizarro the opportunity he needed to capture and to kill Atahualpa in 1533, effectively ending the independence of the Inca Empire. Although the conquistadors focused a lot of their energy on Central and South America, they brought disease into North America as well. Hernando de Soto landed an expedition in Florida in 1539 and explored territory now in the states of Georgia, South Carolina, North Carolina, Tennessee, Alabama, Mississippi, and Oklahoma. Everywhere he went, the conquistador reported that the land was thickly settled with large towns. Now, De Soto didn't stay that long. He died of fever in Louisiana in 1542. And then the region was visited by a few missionaries, but was really then ignored by Europeans for over a century until the French aristocrat La Salle traveled down the Mississippi River in 1670. Where De Soto had recorded seeing fortified towns, La Salle saw no one. The entire region had been emptied by disease and had returned to wilderness. The French explorer reported traveling hundreds of miles without passing a single village. Historians were actually kind of unaware until relatively recently that the American South had once been heavily populated before the arrival of contagious Spanish explorers and missionaries. Spanish invaders had not deliberately infected the natives with all of these diseases. As I said, Europeans still had no idea of how viruses or bacteria worked. But they were quick to take advantage of the opportunities provided by social chaos and military weakness of these native societies that they found in crisis. The Spaniards took over the capital cities in the Inca and the Aztec empires, building Mexico City on top of Tenochtitlan and occupying Cusco for a while before building their own capital on the coast at Lima. And they basically took over these empires as well, slotting themselves into the top positions in the pre-existing governments. Patterns of tribute were maintained, as well as the Inca labor draft called the mita. And as they had in Spain during the Reconquista, conquistadors were rewarded for military service with encomiendas. Encomiendas from a root word that means entrusting. And so they were grants of not only captured territory, but also of the people who lived on it, who the encomendero was theoretically responsible for and entrusted with bringing into the Christian community. This technique had been used in Spain to keep track of conquered Muslims and to make sure that they didn't backslide into their own religion after their forced conversion to Catholicism. Keeping track of the Muslims and the Jews, of course, was one of the things that the Spanish Inquisition was really all about. In Spanish America, there was a much greater emphasis on taxing and working the new peasants rather than on leading them to religion. The decapitation of these native empires and the rapid disappearance of the American population was, of course, unplanned. The overwhelming success of the conquistadors was an unanticipated consequence of this contact between these two previously isolated human populations. 16th-century Europeans, I have to stress, had virtually no understanding of the causes of disease. So the Spanish and the later European explorers and colonists had no idea that visiting the Americas, bringing contagious disease, And then bringing their animals to the New World would eliminate 9 out of 10 people out of a population that had probably been similar in size to Europe's. But they knew how to take advantage of the misfortune of their enemies. The rapid destruction of American populations and cultures created opportunities for conquest and colonization of the Americas that Europeans would not have otherwise enjoyed. And we'll take a closer look at this colonization and the consequences as we continue, of course. But in the meantime, what happened in Europe? As I previously mentioned, American staple crops were adopted by farmers in Europe and in Asia, where they rapidly sparked a population boom. New foods like potatoes were so important in preventing the cyclical famines that regularly hit Europe that they became a key topic in Adam Smith's classic text, An Inquiry on the Wealth of Nations. Many plant species developed by Native Americans are still crucial to the world economy and to world cuisine. They include not only maize and potatoes and cassava, but of course, tomatoes and sweet potatoes and cocoa and chili peppers, and then other products like natural rubber, tobacco, and vanilla. And then finally, quinine, a medicine made from the bark of the Peruvian cinchona tree, was very effective at treating malaria and helped to open the tropics to European colonization, which would have consequences all over the world. And finally, Eurasian plants like sugar and soybeans and oranges and bananas and rice, which probably reached America from Africa along with the enslaved women who were experts at growing it, these were all also extensively cultivated in the Americas as cash crops for shipment back to European markets. Exports of both native and transplanted crops helped to feed growing cities in Europe and freed European agricultural workers to enter Europe and England's new industries. Without inexpensive and abundant American foods, there might have been no rapid European Industrial Revolution. Another American product that was rapidly sent across the Atlantic to Europe and across the Pacific to Asia was money. Although they never found El Dorado, the legendary Indian city of gold, Europeans did find a fair amount of gold. They took literal tons of gold from both the Aztec Empire and the Inca Empire. And then they found even more silver. For example, the Bolivian city of Potosí, which is located in the Andes at an elevation of 13,420 feet, is said to be the world's highest city. Potosí was established by the Spanish between 1542 and 1545 on the site of a long-standing native mining village at the foot of a mountain called the Cerro Rico, which means rich mountain. And this is literally a mountain of silver. Potosí has a current population of about 165,000. And the city's current population is almost identical to Potosí's population in 1660, when this high-altitude mining city was larger than Seville or Madrid or Rome, and when all of the European colonies in North America only had about 75,000 people. Spanish silver coins, called pieces of eight, from the Cerro Rico and from similar mines in Zacatecas in Mexico were so plentiful that they became the international currency of Europe and of much of Asia. Every year, between 1566 and 1815, a treasure fleet sailed from Acapulco to Manila, laden with silver. Another fleet carried not only precious metals, but also spices and expensive Chinese silks and ceramics that had been acquired in Asia from Veracruz on the east side of Mexico back to Spain. Once again, without the money minted in Latin America, there might have been no global commercial boom to finance the Industrial Revolution. And Potosí's story isn't even actually over yet. Although most of the easily extractable silver has been taken out of this mountain centuries ago, the Cerro Rico is still being worked by Bolivian children, whose story is actually told in an award-winning documentary called The Devil's Miner, which you can view on the web if you're interested in learning more. So now another question for discussion before I continue. What were the main economic effects of Spanish colonialism in the Americas for Spain in Europe?